In this video, I'll be making a game like it's 1993.
Okay, so I've decided I want to make a game, but what kind of game am I even making? Well, I think I just wanted something like, you know, it's maze-like or something, and you're this little thing that shoots things. A little thing with your mouse so you can just move around and target things. It bounces up and down in one direction and you can control it the other way. There's like enemies and stuff. Maybe things to shoot. I want a big level. Like, really big level. And I don't know. Maybe there's things to collect. Multiple levels. Something like that. I don't know. I guess there's this little thing down here with lives and, I don't know, things are collected. Needs to be smooth, good performance. I don't have a name yet, so don't mind that, it's just random Swedish.
With a solid plan like that, it's time to pick my tools. There were a number of options for any prospective amateur game developer. One of them probably came with your computer. I'm of course talking about QBasic. One of the included examples, Gorilla.bass, sure makes it clear what can be done with it. It's not quite what I'm looking for though. I want a bit more capability in the graphics department, and I want the result to be an executable binary. QBasic isn't capable of compiling code, so to run anything written in it, you first have to load it in the editor. Another option I considered was a game engine called SPX. It's programmed in and with Pascal, which at the time was a very popular language for hobbyists. The only reason I have for not choosing this option is the fact that SPX makes heavy use of object orientation. I've never managed to wrap my head around object orientation, so I couldn't for the life of me make any sense of the examples. Which brings me to the option I went with, writing my own engine in C, with a few libraries for the difficult stuff. I'm using Borland's Turbo C++ as my development environment. Borland's Turbo series with stripped down versions for hobbyist users. The code will be using regular unextended 16-bit DOS, and I won't be using expanded memory. I plan to use the compact memory model. These are all things that a DOS extender would make irrelevant, which an increasing number of games were using. DOS extenders basically allowed your code to run in 32-bit mode, with no worries about segmented memory and memory models. However, I won't be using a DOS extender. The difference between the memory models is just if code and data use near or far pointers by default. A near pointer is 16 bits long, a far pointer is 32 bits. Both are computed into a 20-bit memory address. For the graphics routine, I'm using a public domain library from the time called xlib. xlib contains a number of routines for setting up various resolutions, hardware scrolling, double buffering, and fast graphics operations, just to name a few things. I had some plans for sound and music, but I ran out of time unfortunately. Anyway, step one is making sure the compiler is working. A quick hello world later and it works! So, first, let's have a quick look at what xlib is capable of by looking at one of the included demo programs. xlib ships as assembly source code. Since Turbo C++ doesn't ship with an assembler, I got some help building the library files. I can now proceed with copying some code from the demo program. What I want to do here is just set my desired video mode, wait 5 seconds, and then exit. I specifically want to know that I can do all this without messing anything up. And it seems fine, but am I in control? Since we're running in 256 color mode, and I'd expect the screen to be initialized to all colors 0, I'm gonna try to set color 0 to something that isn't black. And this too seems to work just fine. From here, I wrote some code to deal with allocating colors to the palette, and drawing tile maps. I've also started thinking a bit about collision detection, but it's gonna be a while before I can test that. Which brings me to, what will I use to draw the graphics? I'm using this shareware utility called 256 Paint. It's a decent enough graphics editor, but the feature I'm really excited about is its support for its very own simple graphics format, which is calling VGA. There's really only one page of documentation on how to load it in your own program, and that's all I need. I've also built this little utility, which allows me to convert this raw graphics data into tile sets that I load into my game. This is also where I will attach collision data later. This was then followed by a very basic level loader. To actually make the levels, I used a simple text file format, which I then ran a conversion utility on that I wrote myself. I also hooked into Xlib's vSync emulation. VGA doesn't have a vSync interrupt, but Xlib can emulate one using the system timer. And I'm using that vSync interrupt and counter as my main timing source. At this point, I think it's time to talk about a major optimization I'm doing. I'm using a bit of hardware scrolling. On VGA, this is limited to your video RAM, as the entire scrolled image has to fit in memory. You can't just load bits in as they approach the view. My map is small enough to fit inside a 256K of video memory. This also means that I don't need to redraw the entire map every frame, which is great for performance. Sprites, however, move independently of the background map, which means they have to be drawn on top of the map. And when they move, the map underneath has to be redrawn. By keeping track of the position of the sprites two frames back, I'm able to only redraw the tiles that had a sprite over it. Why two frames back? Because I'm using double buffering, meaning that the view I'm drawing on and the one that is displaying are different. That way, there is no artifacting from half-drawn frames being sent out to the screen. To showcase the difference of these partial redraws, here's how it crawls when the entire frame is redrawn every frame. And here's with a partial redraw. It's like night and day. Anyway, after that, it's time to implement some actual sprites. Previous examples have been tiles without transparent bits. The transparent bits are done with simple color keying. I've set up my conversion utility to use whatever colors at the top left for transparency. This is also a good time to mention a cool feature of Xlib. It has something called compiled sprites. Drawing graphics with transparent bits is slower than graphics without, as every pixel has to be checked if it's to be drawn or not. Xlib can compile sprites into machine code, which will just slam the visible pixels into video memory without having to check anything. Just one long unrolled loop without any branches. One disadvantage is that it uses almost 4 times more memory than our regular sprites. But if you need speed, it's the way to go. With sprites finally in place, I shifted my focus towards objects, or entities as you might also call them. I had written some code for this that I hadn't gotten around to testing until now. This is also where I managed to crash my computer for the first time. A simple uninitialized pointer I have forgotten to call malloc. This would have led to my entity system overwriting the system interrupt table, which is a plenty good enough reason for any MS-DOS machine to be thrown into a coma. Yes, null pointers are not only writable in MS-DOS, they also lead to an important system data structure. Anyway, with my object system not crashing my system anymore and seemingly somewhat working, I could focus on sprite map collision detection. I want to be able to detect when sprites collide with the map, and have triggers on how to deal with the situation. During the testing of this, I also managed to crash my computer a second time, this time due to an infinite loop. Collision was a bit fiddly, but I eventually got there. Now that collision detection seemed to be working, I figured the next thing on the list was mouse support. I wanted to be able to aim and shoot with the mouse after all. I implemented a mouse cursor as a sprite, and used Xlib's built-in mouse support to handle the interfacing to the driver. For some reason, I decided to just hard-code the mouse cursor into the source code without using a graphics editor. And it's just 1 pixel high? Oh. I had forgotten that sprite compilation routines only work after graphics has been initialized. Xlib doesn't know how many bytes each line of video memory is until you've fully initialized graphics. After fixing that, the mouse cursor now looks correct. Now that I had mouse input, I also wanted to add keyboard input for moving the player side to side. BIOS has some built-in keyboard routines that are easy to access, but they have one critical flaw. You can only tell when a key is pressed, not when it is released. That just isn't good enough for anything where you need to move with precision. On the Simtel Shareware CD-ROM I showed last week, I found some keyboard routines. I just had to have them assembled and plugged into my codebase. And to my surprise, it all worked on the first try. Now that I have player input, I can start adding player logic. Aside from controlling this bouncing thing, I also started adding code for moving between rooms. And after that, it was time to add shooting. I started up by just creating bullets not going anywhere in particular. But then I had to think about how to actually make the aiming work. Normally, this is a relatively mundane geometry problem, to figure out the angle between the player object and the mouse cursor. Calculating the speed from that is then just a simple matter of trigonometry. The issue here is that C only provides floating point versions of the trig functions and square roots. My 386, like many computers like mine, doesn't have floating point support. It would have to be emulated in software. This in itself isn't difficult, as Turbo C++ has this built in, and it takes all of a checkbox to enable. It is, however, quite slow, so I'd like to avoid it. My solution is to normalize the distance in x and y to 15, and then just run that through a lookup table to get the x and y velocities. Given the low resolution of my game, I think this should be close enough. And this then exposed two issues. Bullets sometimes doesn't move, and the sprite cleanup doesn't work properly. The cleanup issue was the easiest to fix. The bullets not always moving had me stumped for a while. While thinking about it, I started working on the camera. I wanted the view to scroll around based on where the player is. And with some fiddling, I was able to get it working decently, with a fairly simple control scheme. After the camera, I started working on a simple state machine to deal with the level transitions and such. After spending some time tweaking that, I had some acceptable room transitions working. And I finally found the issue with the bullet sometimes not moving. I was checking a variable before I calculated its value. A classic example of use of an uninitialized variable, which doesn't generate a warning in this version of Turbo C++. So I was essentially checking if whatever happened to be on the stack since before contained a zero value, and if so, tell the bullet not to move. After this, I started modifying the collision code such that I could tell if the object collided with a tile with any special properties. After that, I added lives and tiles that could kill the player, which was then followed with enemies that could shoot the player. With all the thinking done for the player aiming, the same method and lookup table was applicable here as well. After that, I started adding in paths. This is how I intend to implement moving enemies. They'll just follow a predetermined path. And with object-object collision working, I implemented levers and key disks. You gotta collect something, right? The idea is that key disks permanently unlock a gate of a certain color, while levers only do so until you exit the level. And with that done, I finished up the last couple enemy types I had in mind. And think about what's next.
Okay, so here's the thing. Pretty much everything left on a to-do list is just things that don't affect gameplay that much, so as long as there isn't any game-breaking bugs, I think most of the code is in place. I just need to make more graphics for the other levels, and more importantly, I need to make levels. I just gotta make a game now.
I decided to finish up the last few things on my to-do list, like saving progress and post-death windscreens. I also finished up the status bar with an indication of how many lives you have left and the key disks collected. Finally, I added a main menu. At the time of recording this, I don't know how many levels I'll have time to finish before the video goes up. I'd also like to add more things to shoot, but I'll have to try to get that done off camera. It's looking like this is just going to be a tech demo for an engine rather than an actual game. Anyway, I've put the game and its source code on my website if you want to have a look. But that's all the time I have for this video. Check back next week when I'll continue to struggle with Linux. Until then, thank you for watching.